So congratulations. You've built a web crawler. You've learned to crawl. We're not quite at flying yet, but this is a lot that you've learned in just 3 units. And by learning about lists, we can build any other structure we want, starting from lists, and we'll see lots of other things that we do in the next unit, as well as the units that follow that use lists. We haven't quite finished building a search engine. We have a way of getting a great start towards our corpus, finding all of these pages to crawl. What we need in Unit 4 is the way to get the content from those pages by starting from our seed page and following the crawl web procedure that you wrote. And then we'll use that to build an index so we can respond to queries when someone's doing a search for a particular term. The other thing we'll do in Unit 4 is we'll learn a little more about how the internet and the web work.
I'm here with Anna Patterson, who's built a bunch of search engines, including building the world's largest index of the web, and now works for Google. And we've just finished building a very simple web crawler. I want Anna to tell us something about how things are different if you want to build a web crawler that works at the scale that Google has to deal with.
So there's three main issues with scaling up a web crawler. One is the normal politeness that you need on the web. The second one is how you get a bunch of machines involved in crawling, not just one. And the last issue is how to consume a lot of bandwidth so that you keep the expensive resource busy while still being polite. So on politeness, there's a line in the robots.txt that each domain tells you how often you can crawl that domain. There's a number of problems with that, which is that multiple domains can be hosted with a hosted service, and they could be hosted even on one machine. So even though you're being polite to one domain, you're actually really hurting a hosting service or you're hurting a machine. So you have to make plans in order to not hit one machine or one domain too hard. The next thing is that if you crawl on just one machine, the state is very good. And it's really easy to keep the state of the crawl on the one machine, but then it's hard to make a very big search engine because you get as much as one machine will crawl. So, of course, in practice, you crawl on thousands of machines. Now, if you're going to obey politeness, that means that each of your 1,000 machines needs to tell the other ones what it has crawled and what it's about to crawl and what it's going to crawl in 20 minutes, right? All of this communication overhead can actually slow down the crawler, which actually hurts your aim of having a big search engine. The last part is that you want to max out your bandwidth. So one thing that people do instead of trying to lessen the communication is they pre-process the corpus that they already have. So when you've crawled a set of pages, you can process them and extract out all the links that they point to. You can then normalize those links so that yahoo.com and www.yahoo.com wind up being the same string, and now you can farm those strings out to your 1,000 machines, and now they don't have to communicate because they know they're not going to hit the same domain. However, they could accidentally hit the same hosting service and the same machine, but you can take care of that ahead of time as well.
Thanks a lot, Anna. I hope those of you who think about unleashing your web crawler on the world pay careful attention to what she said about politeness.
Thank you for having me, and students, good luck on your search engines.
So I hope we'll see you back soon. You'll have a homework for Unit 3 that's going to be quite challenging, and I look forward to seeing all your answers to it.